Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to let you go with that one. That was great. I just have a couple of announcements to bring to your attention. There is Coffee Ann immediately following service. The stewardship committee has put that together, so you are all invited to come down and share in fellowship. And also to remind you, at 1:30 is our piano and cello concert. We're hoping the first one in a long series that we'll be able to offer to the community. Helen, I believe you've invited everybody before. We're going to have a reception afterwards. A lovely reception afterwards to follow where we can greet the visitors that have come to hear, and also share our thanks with the musicians that are so... are so joyously sharing their talents with us and with the community. That's all I have by way of announcements.
Next Saturday, the 29th of June, we're having an outdoor cleanup day. We're scheduling it for to start about 9 o'clock in the morning. Hopefully done about noon. We got trees to trim, mulch to spread, weeds to pull, some signs to be painted. We got a little bit of everything to do. So if you can spare a few hours, come down and join us. Bring rakes, shovels, whatever you clippers, whatever you think we need. We'll have some yard waste bags here. We could use some yard waste stickers, but we don't have any. We've got the bags here. So Saturday at 9 o'clock, hope to be done by about noon. Hope to see as many people there as possible.
Thank you. Hey, just so you know, this isn't going to be parking on the scale of Fall Fest. We're just going to be doing the front parking lot, and then that little bit of grass that's right in front of the garage. So we're not going to have people running into the back and doing stuff. Once it's filled up in the parking lot, then we'll be done and close down and wait for people to leave and people to come in. But it is something that was built into the budget. We are we guesstimated about $1,000, so we can use all the help that we can get. You just have to sit there and take money, and it would be nice if you smiled, but even that's not a prerequisite, okay? So if you can help us out with that, it would be greatly, greatly appreciated. Thank you, Rachel and David, for sharing that. Yeah, Lisa. So if you can stick around, just come down to the front and Lisa will tell you what to do. She's good at that too. She's done that with me, so I know she's more than capable. Anything else that needs to be brought up for the good of the congregation? Well, seeing nothing, God speaks most clearly in silence. Please join with me responsively in our call to worship. The wind buffets and blows, cascading rocks down the mountainside. The earthquake shakes and shatters, shaking the very foundation of the earth. The fire crackles and roars, licking at the roots of life. Where is God to be found? Listen carefully. So I'd invite all that are able now to please stand as we join together in hymn number 317, All People That on Earth Do Dwell. Please join with me in the morning prayer. Living God, you call us to yourself so that we may live in wholeness with ourselves and our neighbors. Unchain your people and set us free to rejoice in your saving word. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. I would now invite you to turn to those around you, passing the peace of Christ on this wonderful day. Okay. Do we have any? Do we have, do we have any kids? Oh, I see, okay. Thank you, ladies. We come to that time in our service where we have the opportunity to lift up and share with our sisters and brothers any concerns or joys that we have in our life at this time. So I would invite any that are so led to lift up and to share with the gathered body your joys and concerns.
Just to let everyone know, for those of you who remember Don and Inez Lorenz, Inez passed away on Wednesday after a very long and difficult struggle with Alzheimer's, and her wake and funeral was yesterday.
Thank you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Oh, I'm back to my old ways. It's good and bad. I tell you the good news first. I am still young enough to learn. And what I learned this week is what it means to have your computer hacked or hacked in, whatever it is. But anyway, I found out it's completely dead. So that's the good news. I learned what it means. The bad news is I have no information. And I'm very lucky that I remember my own name and my birthday. And I feel like I walk down the street naked because all my information is out there somewhere. Okay, I had good news too, but whatever. I can't remember. Anyway, maybe the good news is, I was very sick beginning of the week. I could not walk. I was throwing up, and I thought I had a stroke, but apparently I didn't because I can use my hands and my feet, and I can walk. I was very dizzy. I couldn't walk by myself. But now I think I'm 99.9% myself, and I don't know if it's good or bad, but that's it. Thank you.
Well, luckily, it didn't even begin to inhibit your speech, so that was great. So you could share with us. We're glad you're feeling better and you're here, and I'm sure there are many out here that can empathize with having your computer hacked and losing stuff. So, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
I just wanted to let everyone know that Virginia Osmus passed away on Friday. Virginia Osmus was a lifetime member of St. Peter. She sang in the choir, and for those of us who have been here forever, she was probably one of our favorite third grade teachers. Well, she was the only third grade teacher at that time, but she was a favorite teacher. So we ask for prayers for her family. Virginia was 95, lived a wonderful life, was a wonderful, wonderful person. And I just wanted everyone to know that she had passed away. So prayers for her family.
Thank you. Lord, in your mercy.
I just want to add a little bit to that. And that is that I talked with her son, Kim. And he and Richard hope to bring Virginia and Howard back up here this summer, late this summer. And then maybe we might be able to recognize the wonderful lives that they've lived. I also want to say that, good news, last week my son Robert got married. Yay! They had such a beautiful ceremony. Patty was there, Patty and Bob. It was wonderful. And please pray for them because their honeymoon is in Dominican Republic.
Oh.
I have been praying every day. They have to text me and tell me they're okay. So just keep the prayers for them.
Thank you. Lord, in your mercy.
I would ask for prayers for my friend Don Tornow. He had cervical surgery on Wednesday. He did come home Friday. He's doing pretty well, but he has to wear this, I guess I'll call it a horse collar for 6 weeks, where he can't bend, he can't twist, and he can't lift. So it's a difficult thing, but I'm hoping he's going to be all right.
Thank you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Well, this week, after feeling pretty yucky for the last 10 or 11 days, Kathy finally made me go to the doctor. And I went to the doctor, and she listened and did x-rays and said I should have been in 10 or 11 days ago because...
We told everybody.
Lord, in your mercy. And I have pneumonia. I've been on medication for it and taking it as easy as I can. Kathy's the one that's suffering the worst because even with the medication, I'm coughing continually, especially at night. I have come to discover what the sofa and the guest room are like. Stop it, she says. No, she won't let me leave because she wants to make sure that I'm going to be okay. I've been off for since Tuesday. Poncha asked if I was going to be here today. I said I would have to be literally in the hospital not to be here today to preach. And even then, I'd probably talk to Ernie and we'd work out some kind of Skype thing. So I ask for your prayers for healing, prayers for continued tolerance and love for Kathy, I'll keep you posted. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. So for these things that we have shared, our concerns and our joys, for the concerns and the joys that each of us have and that we carry in our hearts and our spirits and we choose to share privately with God, I would invite us now to bow our heads and be in a time and a spirit of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this absolutely marvelous day, this opportunity, this privilege to be able to gather here in this glorious and blessed and sacred space, to come together with sisters and brothers in Christ to join our hearts and our voices in offering you our thanks and our praise. God, on this day we pray for our beloved St. Peter's, for all that this church has meant to this community, to this whole area, for the many lives that have been touched, those that have joined the church, those that have a relationship with the church, those in the community who've been touched by the missions and the ministry of our church. God, we pray for strength and courage to listen to your voice, to be filled and led by your Spirit as we go on into a new time, into a changing world. We pray that we have the wisdom to find new ways to reach the people where they are, new ministries to be able to offer people as they need, that we never, ever dumb down the gospel or water it down to make it easier, but that we find ways to speak to this world in a language that they can understand. And that most importantly, we preach the gospel of Jesus Christ upon which our beloved church is founded and built. And we bring it to the world through our actions, through our deeds, and through our choices, so that as people see us, they can know who we are, and they can know whose we are. O Holy One, we lift this prayer up to you this morning as we have shared our concerns and our joys And we bring them all to you when we pray together in one voice. Our Father. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now hear these words from the prophet Joel. God says, "Then afterward I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions." Hear what the Spirit says to the church. God is still speaking. So on the fourth Sunday in June, in 1914, the worship service was led by a young, nervous, intimidated person, me. What?
1814.
2014. Okay, let's start over. Ready? Okay.
Good morning.
I have an excuse. It was an exciting day for Kathy and myself. And I think it was in the life of the congregation. I know it was in the life of the six members that were on the search committee, because it meant that they were finally done. We had over 120 people that day, 103 of which were voting members. And the congregation voted overwhelmingly to call me to serve as pastor and teacher with the people of St. Peter's United Church of Christ. I think, and I know I will be corrected if I'm wrong, I think that we've done some really good stuff in 5 years. I think that we've been able to face some of the difficulties that occurred in the life of St. Peter's over the past, and we've been able to develop a new relationship between pastor and between congregation, and I think within the congregation too. I know that each and every Sunday I can feel the spirit of love and warmth and Christian fellowship just sitting back there listening to you all. You enjoy being together. You enjoy each other's company. You respect each other. And I think look for ways to be able to uplift and to nurture sisters and brothers as they find and claim their voice in God's creation, their duty as a disciple of the risen Christ. Overall, I'm extremely proud of our church and where we are. Now, does that mean that for the past 5 years, everything has been absolutely perfect and hunky-dory? No. But tell me any group, including your families, where you can look back on 5 years and say, this was an idyllic period. There was nothing wrong. Everybody got along with everybody. If you tell me that, well, I will probably question your sanity or your memory. Because it just doesn't happen. There are, especially at the beginning, learning pains. How does the pastor interact with the congregation? How does the congregation deal with the pastor? And we have had some significant growing pains with me learning what you expect of the pastor of St. Peter's United Church of Christ, and me telling you what I expect for the pastor of St. Peter's United Church of Christ. And I think it's fairly safe to say that where we are now is a good, solid balance. I feel comfortable now going to ministry meetings and being able to share ideas and viewpoints and suggestions. Are they all listened to and agreed with? Of course they're not. But at least I know I'm heard. At least I know, for the most part, that I am respected. I think that you have come to learn what you can expect from me. I will tell you what I think. If that is good, I will tell you. If I am not happy, I will tell you. And I know there are a few people here that I've had those discussions with. And yet we still work together, loving and respecting each other, doing all that we can as individuals and as a gathered body to faithfully serve the risen Christ and the living God here where we have all been called and been planted. Now, I have shared with the council, I've shared with other people, ever since I started in a career, you know, not jobs that you did through college, but once I started my career in computers, my dad gave me some words of wisdom that I have lived by. And it's every 5 years, you take some time and you sit back and you look at where you are. You determine as honestly as you can, am I still happy? Do I still find satisfaction in the job that I'm doing? Do I feel that I'm still effective? Do I feel that I am growing? And the group that I am working with and supervising, are they still growing? Are the analysts that worked underneath of me finding ways to become the best that they can be in their job, progressing and moving up? And then for the last 23 years, every 5 years, asking, is the congregation still growing? Is the congregation still moving forward? And I think for the most part, I have looked at that, and I felt very good about where we are in these 5 years. Now, I will confess, to some degree of disappointment in myself as I serve with you as pastor and teacher. You see, one of the things that you all put in your profile that you wanted to see really, really happen was to have a growing Christian education program. And especially you singled out adults to have opportunities for us, for the adults of St. Peter's to be able to gather, to learn and to grow in our faith and our understanding of what it means to be a disciple. The other thing was that you wanted to see a real sense of developing a spirituality of St. Peter's. Again, realizing that spirituality is something that we have, but it is something that we are called to, well, that we're called to cultivate, that we're called to develop, that we're called to water and nourish so that it can grow. And quite frankly, when I look at where we are right now, I have no, personally, and I know I get in trouble with this, I have no choice but to see this as a failure on my part, as something that I have not been able to do. The message has not touched you in a way that compels you to want to do these kinds of things. Now, that's not all bad, because you have to have some place to go, right? You always have to have room to improve. And I know where mine is now, here at St. Peter's, to give you what you were searching for when you called the new pastor to St. Peter's in 2014. So I will continue to prayerfully consider options and ways that we can come together in small groups and large to build this sense of community with our adult Christian education. Now, you know what that means, don't you? Y'all got to work with me. I can't just offer stuff and have nobody show up, which, quite frankly, is quite often the case. So that I will come on Thursday at 7 p.m. already, and there'll be two people, and one of them is my wife. See, we have to decide exactly what we want as a congregation. We are at a true liminal point in the life of St. Peter's. We are at the beginning of a new era, a new culture, and a new society that calls for us as a church to reevaluate the things that we saw as priorities 6 years ago when you put together the profile that led me to express my interest and then led to you calling me to be in ministry with you. Times change, and people change. And the only way that the church, the only way that St. Peter's United Church of Christ can continue to grow and to thrive is for us to change with it. And I know just how scary that is for a lot of people, for a lot of reasons. One is, let's face it, we're comfortable. We know what's going to happen. We know how the church year is going to proceed and what will be offered and how it will be offered. We have our services of worship and our times of gathering in a way that we're used to, that we don't have to think about. Our understanding and our sense, and it is not just us. It is most of the mainline churches that exist out there in the world. Our understanding is this is the way we have done it. And if they want to come in the doors, they better learn how to do it our way. They're going to sing our songs. They're going to pray our prayers. They're going to use the words and language that we use, that we feel comfortable with. And if they don't, well, there's the door. And I don't think it comes as a surprise to anybody that there has not been a huge number breaking down our doors to come in. And again, not just us, but quite frankly, I don't care about anybody else. I'm worried about us. I'm worried about who we are. I'm worried about who we are going to be. I'm worried about how we are going to preach the gospel out there in a way that touches and reaches all of God's children. Not just the people that sound and look like us, not just the people that have the same ideas, but all of God's children. Opening our doors to a diversity of people, of ideas, of individuals, of backgrounds, of nationalities, of ethnicities, of race, of gender, all of it. We have to be ready to find ways to speak to them. And it scares us because it's going to be different. At the last congregational meeting in January, a committee was established to begin the process of amending and updating the Constitution and bylaws. The committee met a half a dozen different times. And the dictate that I kept every meeting beginning with and in the middle and at the end, we want to have something that represents who we are. Not who we were. Not who we wish we were, but who we are. This is a church, rightfully so, proud and attached to our history and our past. Without the endeavors, without the faithful efforts and pursuits of sisters and brothers that came before us, we would not be here today. And it is good and it is right that we celebrate them, that we celebrate who we were, but we cannot maintain that same way of thinking and that same status quo. The same message that started this church in 1868, while at the very core is always the same, the gospel of Jesus Christ, it was preached in a different way than we do. If the pastor got up from 1868 and preached today, I would be willing to say there would be one person in this church that might be able to follow him. Yeah, Ilsa. Because it, what?
Thank you.
You're welcome. See, you, now you got something next week for your joy, right? So. It was in a different language. And not only was it in a different language, but there was a different understanding of the world. There are new things that we have discovered about Scripture, about the history of the church, that allows us to be able to develop new ideas, yet still keeping with that core message. Basically, we are going out there into the world, preaching the way St. Peter's has always preached, and acting the way St. Peter's has always acted. And while that was wonderful and it got us to where we are, it cannot continue. The person you love most in the world, picture them in your mind. They have a catastrophic heart attack. Rush to the hospital. Do you want the doctors that are taking care of your loved one to be using the same practice of medicine that they did in the 50s? How about the 60s? The 90s? Even the zeros? We want the latest. We want the greatest. The practice of medicine has not changed. The goal is to heal the body. But the ways that it has practiced have changed and have developed and have grown. And through that, people are living through catastrophic heart attacks that 10 years ago would not be with us this day. We can be no different as St. Peter's United Church of Christ. We have to, we must find new ways to reach out there into the world. We must find new ways to reach the people here, to find ways that engages us. Maybe that means a whole bunch of small groups, and that we don't have what used to be, because I've heard it before and I've been a part of it at other churches, the big adult Bible study where you had 30 or 40 adults that were there. And it was led by the pastor. And the pastor would read a chapter from the book. And you would discuss it until time was up. And then you would go home. And then you would come back the next week. And you would start with the next chapter. My guess is that is not going to work here. It's not going to work touching the people out there. And I don't think it's going to resonate here. I think we need to be open to, again, different ways, small groups, engaging people where they are. Jesus said, wherever there are two or more. Now, of course, my guess is Jesus never spent a week putting together a Bible study and then having two people show up. Or he would have said, if there are any, seven or more. We need to find new ways to live the gospel. How do we reach out to the community? How do we spread the gospel? How do we share who we are? And quite frankly, in the last 5 years, we haven't done a lot of it. And the big reason is it scares the heck out of all of us. Going out there and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, that always brings into people's mind the vision of the crazy person on the corner with the poster that says, "Repent, for the world has come to an end." There are new ways where we can be evangelists, where we can engage the people where they are. And see, that's what we need to work at the most. That is going to be the hardest thing, I think, for us as St. Peter's Church. Putting aside the way we have always done it. And doing it a new and different way. Which all too often means giving up the control. Going out there and hearing what the people want. Not what we want to give them, but what they want. And then offering it. And if we find out the way that we have decided to offer what they have wanted doesn't work, that means, okay, we tried something, we learned what doesn't work, now let's move on and try something else. We cannot use the same tried and true methodology of, we did that once before and it didn't work, so we really can't do it again. No, you did that once before, it didn't work, and you can't do it the way you did it before. But now you do it a different way and a new way. What that is going to mean more than anything is a complete commitment of all the members of St. Peter's United Church of Christ to be a part of the life and the vitality of who we are. There is nobody that is too old that cannot find some way to serve. There is, once they start walking and talking, they're not too young. We need to start engaging the children when they are young and bringing them up so it's not like, okay, you're 13, now you're confirmed, now you're going to do this stuff. Do what? We need to realize that the only way that we can move on, the only way that we can continue to grow is to continue to change. Now, I have started with the council over the last couple of meetings. We have talked about some stuff, and we're going to continue to talk about some different things. And I am going to continue to bring forth new and different ideas, not just ones that I sit around and spring, but believe it or not, despite what some people think, I do not just work on Sunday from 9:30 to 10:30. And I don't only just work in the office. Many times my best reading and best thoughts are like 11 o'clock when Kathy's sitting in the bathtub relaxing and I'm sitting in the chair reading and nobody is around. And it's quiet. But see, that's something you all can do too. You do not have to be a trained theologian or sociologist or even a teacher to come up with new ideas. You might talk to a friend that does something in a book club, not at your book club, that just sounds really exciting to you. I am not above stealing other people's ideas. Because if it worked for them, let's see how it can work for us. Now, if we do a book club, obviously it's going to be a little different than the secular book club, but we're starting new things. We're reaching out there. We're beginning to develop a presence out in the social media where people can hear and read about all the things that we are doing. Let's keep offering things. Try it. Does it work? That's fine. Trying it and not working is not a failure. It's learning how not to do it the next time. The only time it's a failure is if you just give up. And the one thing that I have learned from the history of our august body is that the people of St. Peter's have not given up and have made their way through a number of extremely difficult circumstances over the years and keep going and keep moving. And we owe it to those people that gathered, those 17 families that gathered in 1868 to charter and create St. Peter's. We owe it to them to keep moving forward and to keep moving on. This first 5 years, I think, has been a wonderful way for us to be introduced to each other, to come to know each other, to become comfortable with each other. Now it's time to take the next step. Now it's time to take that comfort and to challenge it. To challenge ourselves. To challenge our faith. To challenge our understanding of what it means to be church. Because we are church in a completely different way than they were in 1868. When men and women would have sat separately. When men would have completely and 100% ruled and dominated the church. 1868, the women of the church basically had two jobs. Do the fellowship meals, take care of the funerals, that kind of stuff. And take care of the men. That was your job, that was your responsibility. Now, I would be willing to bet that we have changed some since 1868, and that the women of St. Peter's Church would not be comfortable now if we were to say, okay, women, shut up, go down there and cook lunch for us, and make sure we have everything we need to do our job. I would not see a sixth year as pastor of United Church of Christ. I probably wouldn't see tomorrow. So change is something that we are used to. It is a part of who we are. And it is a part of Christ Church. A church that has changed from when the apostles had that first Pentecost that brought the church into being. It is a very, very different thing than it was then. It continues to be something that's very different, and it is incumbent upon us to find a way to reach out to that newness, to encounter and engage with those differences, sharing that message which is at the core of our beloved church and all our ministries. The love of God. The resurrection of Christ. And the power of Christ's Holy Spirit. May we go into these next few years ready and willing to accept the change and engage the differences. Amen. So now I would invite you, if you are able, to please stand. We're going to sing the song, Come, O Spirit, with Your Sound. It's an insert in your bulletin, and Lisa's going to play it all the way through once. Please be seated. For the sake of those who have yet to hear the word of God, for those who are in need of our bounty, and for the discipline that comes with sacrifice, let us bring our tithes and our offerings. Please join with me in the prayer of dedication. Thanks be to you, Creator of the universe, for earth and sky, water and rock, creatures and plants, that we may have life enough to live and to offer for others. Thanks to you, crucified and risen Lord, who shows us the face of God, so that we may see in our brothers and sisters a member of Christ's own body and rejoice. Thanks be to you, Holy Spirit, giver of life, who moves within us as we pray and teaches us compassion that we might love our neighbors as ourselves. Accept our offering as signs of your never-failing care. In the name of all that is most precious in your sight. Amen. Now let us join together in hymn number 619, God Will Take Care of You.
Thank you.
please join with me in the commission for this week. We go in peace to care for those who cross our path, to give voice to those who need your help, to notice what is beautiful and what is amiss, to counter injustice and guard what is good, and to rest and work, mindful of God's desire for us to grow in our faith and our discipleship. Now let us join together in our prayer for peace. Let there be peace on earth. It's in the back cover of the hymnal. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and give you mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen.